קשורה לקלרנה? כי מי שאמורה לדבר מקלרנה ומחה. טוב, מדהימים בעניינים. ערב טוב לכולם. כיף לראות שכבר מיטאפ מספר 4 ואנשים ממשיכים להגיע והפרצופים קצת מתחלפים. מה שאומר דברים רעים על אנשים שלא באו, אבל בסדר, נסלח להם. כמו תמיד, משתדלים לשמר את העקרונות של המיטאפ, שזה הרצאות מעניינות שמועברות על ידי אנשים שבאמת צברו ניסיון הלזון עם ריאקט, ככה שלא תרגישו שבזבזתם זמן שיכולתם להקדיש בקריאה של טוטוריאל. היום ההרצאה הראשונה, אייל ידבר על ריאקט נייטיב, משהו נושא שבאמת עוד לא היה לנו פה. הוא מתמקד באמת על איך אפשר לקחת את הידע שאנשים פה צברו בפיתוח בריאקט, ובדרך הכי קצרה להפוך את עצמם גם למובייל דבלופרס. וההרצאה השנייה תהיה יותר שיתוף מהניסיון של פיתוח פרויקט שרץ הרבה זמן בריאקט, עם הבעיות הקשות שעלו והכיוונים שנלקחו, או כמו שרשמנו, ריאקט War Stories. ולפני שמתחילים, מילה טובה למארחים שלנו, כבר פעם שנייה, עם פיצות והרבה פינוקים. חברת קלרנה באמת מארחת אותנו בצורה מאוד מתוקתקת, ובאופן כללי מעורבת בכמה קהילות של קוד פתוח, שזה כבוד גדול, והם גם מגייסים. אז מי שמעניין אותו לעבוד בחברה בינלאומית, שתמיד עובדת עם הטכנולוגיות הכי חדישות, עם רובי און ריילס, עבדתי גם עם ריאקט, הייתה פה הרצאה מעולה של חואן בפעם הקודמת, אז מוזמן לשלוח אימייל פה למיכל תירוש, אישה נכבדה בפני עצמה. אז יאללה, להתחיל. בבקשה.
אוקיי. טוב, אני עושה את האנגלית, כן? I'm here to talk about React Native. My name is Eyal Eizenberg. I'm an engineering team lead at Samanage. We're based in Netanya. I've been working with Ruby on Rails for about 4 years, and like every Rails company, we do a lot of client side also. We use jQuery, Backbone, Marionette, Underscore, and recently also React. I have to say, I don't know any Java or any Objective-C, and I'm actually kind of interested in who here does know some Java or Objective-C. Anybody? So we got about maybe 20-30%, something like that. Our story with React Native started about, I think, a year ago, actually, before even we thought about React Native. Our app is completely Rails, and all our team are Rails developers. We all use Ruby and Rails, and we love it. But none of us knew Java or Objective-C, or some of us knew a little Java, but definitely not Android development, so we could use that to grow forward. And we had no choice. Our app was mainly a web app, and we needed the time to get started and build a mobile app. And we started with Android because most of our developers love Android, and we have a lot of Android phones, so that's what we went for first. And we had the same issue that most young startups have when they decide that it's time to go mobile. Our first issue was obviously that bringing a mobile developer is expensive. You have to hire a new person who's dedicated just for this, just for developing a mobile app. We thought about using an external company, maybe hire them. But this is problematic too, because, well, first of all, they're very expensive, and it's not a good long-term solution. Because once you have errors, you got bugs, you need to hire them again, you need to ask them. They're not really engaged into your product, and it takes time for them just to know what you're talking about. So we went with hiring a mobile developer. We hired one guy to do Android development. And we faced some more issues with that. First of all, the guy, he was a Java Android developer. He didn't know any Rails. So we had to appoint somebody who worked with him tightly and make sure that all our APIs would conform to his way of building an app. It took him a while to understand our business logic, how our app works, what we do exactly. So there was a really, really steep learning curve until we started seeing some fruits from this guy. And he's a great guy, by the way, no offense. It was a very difficult process. And also the design work with him was difficult because designing for Android, it's difficult. It's all these XMLs and Java and Eclipse and those heavy, really heavy tools. And every build takes a long time. It was really, really heavy. And there is also the ultimate question of what happens after a year or two or three once the mobile app pretty much hits a plateau and it's ready to go. You make a GA, and now what? What's happening with this guy? Does he stay? Does he do support? It's a lot of questions and a lot of problems with that area. About 4 months ago, I guess something like that, I discovered React, and I went to JavaScript conference, and then I heard about React Native. And I looked it up, and I really liked what I saw. I fell in love with React, and I realized that I could use this great tool to build native apps. And I really like this quote by one of the developers in Facebook. Said, "We're not chasing the right ones, run anywhere pipe dream. What we want to do is chase the learn ones, right anywhere paradigm." Which I think is really great, because there are no silver bullets. You can't develop to every platform with the exact same code. But the great thing about it, that if you learn React once, you can develop for a web app, for Android, and for iOS, and there are more platforms coming soon as well. So, about React Native. Basically, their idea was that you write your code using the same old React JavaScript that we all know and love, but under the hood, what happens is that this code is transformed into Objective-C, or Java in the case of Android. And what's great about it is because you develop like you developed a hybrid app, or not a hybrid, HTML5 app, which you write in JavaScript, but you're actually getting a native app. You have to run this code using Xcode or Mac, or if you go for Android, you actually run the Android SDK, the Android development tools with it. The guys who developed it is Facebook once again, and they use it on several production apps themselves. I'm going to get into that a little bit in a while. And what's really great about it, and I really love, is that it leverages Node, Node.js, and now it's Node.io. So you can use, I wouldn't say every Node npm package, but you can use a lot of them, and it's really comfortable. I love Lodash or underscore, and it was so easy to bring it in and use all the great tools that all the great functions that you can use from Lodash. Really easy to bring it in. I'm sure there are similar stuff in Objective-C, but this was so easy, it was ridiculous. So why should you use React Native? Like I said, you get the native experience, you get the native code underneath the hood, but you're writing JavaScript again. So it's really great. All your web developers that know React with almost little to no effort, they can start writing great Android or iOS apps. Our iOS app, it's about, I'm developing it for about 2 months, something like that, and we are about 2 weeks away from going from internal testing into external beta testing. And we're using a lot of great stuff in it, and it was really easy, and the work with the designers has also been really easy because we're using JavaScript and we're using something kind of like CSS, so it's really great and easy to learn. The performance, those of you wondering about performance, there are, as far as I know, there are no major issues with performance. We're using a different thread to use the JavaScript, and the other threads use the other iOS applications that you need, calculations or rendering images and stuff like that. The project runs in Xcode. I'm talking mainly about iOS here because that's what I have the most experience on, but the experience is pretty similar with Android. The project runs in Xcode, so you do need a Mac in order to run this, to run iOS apps. However, instead of just running the project, you can use Sublime or Vim or Atom or whatever editor you love, and you just code there, and you have your emulator, your simulator running next to you. You only need to open Xcode pretty much to deploy to test flight, which we also do, and it's easy, it works great. And you don't need to use this horrible tool called Xcode. It's really, really nasty. You can use the iOS simulator. It's great. It's easy to use. It's fun. You can use all the gestures and all that stuff that comes with it. And what's really great is you can also run it on a mobile device very easily. You just connect the USB cable, change a small setting, and I've already showed the run here, what we're going to be building ourselves, and it already runs on my iOS phone, my iPhone. What's great also about it, because we're running a Node project pretty much, we can use debugger points in Chrome. So we write JavaScript, we debug it in Chrome, but we're getting Objective-C underneath the hood, which I think is pretty great. I think the guys did a really marvelous job here. And like always, when I think about React, when people ask me what is React, I try to describe it as building Legos. That's what I think of. And every Lego part has all the stuff it needs in order to render on the screen. And you can reuse it everywhere you want. So if I'm building, for example, in our app, I've built some kind of this avatar component, which shows the avatar of the user. I can take this exact code, throw it into my Android native app, and it will work perfectly. Of course, like I said, no silver bullets, so not all of the code will work here and here, but a lot of it you can share and use the components from here to there. There is another point here, I think I forgot to write it, actually. Well, I don't need to talk to you about all this boring stuff here, but what's kind of great is that it's open source, and like I said, you can use all the packages from NPM, well, not all of them, but a lot of them. For me, at least, for the point here of going mobile, I felt recently, since I've been doing so much web development, that I've kind of been getting behind on the race, I would say. The entire world is going mobile apps everywhere, there's a big shift towards it, and I felt like, I don't know Objective-C, I don't know Java, I'm getting left behind, and I need to make myself more relevant. And with React Native, that's exactly how I feel now, and it's really easy, it's really fun. I've been having, the last couple of months, having a lot of fun. It supports ES6, right out of the box. You don't need to do anything, you just write the code, ES6, and boom, you're ready to go. Personally, I love CoffeeScript, so I use CoffeeScript with Gulp, which changes my code from CoffeeScript to ES6, and then everything compiles together. Another great point here is that the main code you are running basically gets bundled, all this JavaScript gets bundled into one file, and this is handed off to the Xcode iOS project. What that means is that essentially, we can have continuous deployment for iOS apps because we don't need to recompile the entire code all the time. So we can just deploy this app one time to the iOS store, get it approved, which takes by itself 3 to 5, I heard even 8 days for an approval. And once it goes live, all you need to do is that once your app gets starts up, it goes, makes a call, grabs all the JavaScript, it needs this bundle file, and you're good to go. And once you have changed, you just push that bundle file again, and the users won't even know it, and they have a new version, bug fixes, and all the stuff you're used to from continuous deployment. There are several platforms which you can use to do this. You can find them on the web, and it's really great, because right now I know that every time you find a bug in iOS, you have to wait 3 to 5 days just to fix this bug. This is one of my favorite points about React Native. When the guys in Facebook, they started developing React Native, before that they wanted to develop their Ads Manager app. And their Ads Manager app, they saw that it was going to be pretty complex. There's a lot of stuff there, there are graphs, there's like a ton of options to pick, and your screen changes as you decide what you want. And they said that they're going to build this app in 18 months using Objective-C. But right around that time, they started using React Native, and they said, what the hell, let's give it a try, since we tried it on a different app, or a groups app, which was kind of hybrid. And this is what actually happened. They developed their iOS app for the Ads Manager in 5 months, and another 3 months just to port it into Android. So 8 months total, they did something that they were supposed to do in 18 months just for the iOS app. I think that's pretty amazing. There's always the big question of what happens if Facebook drops this project. All I can say is they're very, very heavily invested into React and React Native itself. They use it in their web app, the React. They use it in their mobile apps for the Ads Manager, the groups, and I know they intend to change and create more apps using React Native. As opposed to other big companies which develop JavaScript platforms, because they use it themselves, the chances that they'll change their API so drastically, which will break everything, is very low. I know that a lot of people were on Angular 1, they went to Angular 2, and went to Zoom Beta, and they suffered greatly. Before I start diving into the code, and we're going to code a little bit, kind of start to feel how it feels to develop with React Native. What you need a map, and you need Node.js in the recent Xcode. I know there are some people who can make that work on Linux and Windows for the Android version, but obviously if you develop through iOS, since you're running native code, you gotta have a Mac, you gotta have Xcode. The React Native docs, they're pretty great implementation that they built. It shows all their components that they made themselves, and all the properties that you need to run them. UI Explorer is kind of their little mini project, which shows all the native components that they give you built in, and you can also see it online. React Native Playground, it's kind of like a JS Fiddle, but for React Native apps. So you can make a small React Native app, throw it into this thing, and share it online instantly. And for that, technically, you don't even need a Mac, you can just use any computer. And React parts and components, you can find more components. Flexbox, you gotta familiarize yourself with Flexbox. You will see that we are gonna write something that kind of looks like CSS. However, when they wanted to implement the CSS here in the easiest way for the users, and they found that to be Flexbox. I had no idea what Flexbox was before. Anybody here uses it in CSS? Well, I'm actually surprised, but so Flexbox is a really easy way to have layouts of your divs on the screen, having them side by side without using floats and clears and all that horrible stuff that personally I hate. So there are all these links, you're going to find it in my presentation, we're going to upload it, and you can find a really great Flexbox tutorial. And the last point is, you should use Flux or Redux or one of those things, because if you start small and you just do all these callbacks, and pretty soon you'll find yourself in the eponymous callback hell that everybody knows about in Node. So using Flux or Redux, everything really gets much, much easier, and you can really start developing quickly. So, before we dive into the code, here's some of the things we're going to look at. We're going to look at the basic structure of an app, at least the way I believe that it's a good way to structure it. I'm sure that other people are going to disagree. I'm going to talk a little bit about Navigator and Navigator iOS. But basically, what our app is going to do, we're going to build a React Native app for React Israel Meetups. We're going to grab some JSON from meetup.com through their API. We're going to render a list. It's going to show all the events that were in the past that we're going to be also. We're going to navigate to an event, and we're going to talk a little bit about Interaction Manager and animated and stuff like that. So, shall we? יש פה במקרה משהו להחזיק את המיקרופון? Great, thanks. Like I said, a good place to start Their project is probably here in React Native Docs. In the React Native Docs, once you need to start, you need to have Xcode. Okay, so like I said, we need Xcode. You just need to pre-install Node and you're pretty much good to go. In order to start a project, you need to npm install the React command line interface, and then you do React Native init and the name of your project. I already did this and I started our project. This is the you're not going to see much here, but what you start out with, first of all, you get a package JSON, which is straight out of Node, with the React Native package. I've also added a couple more packages to it. I've added the events and flux packages, so I can get flux going pretty easily, and Lodash, because it's always handy to have it around. By the way, all this project is going to be on GitHub. There's going to be one branch for getting started, getting off the ground, which is where this project is right now, and hopefully another commit or another branch when we're done here. And feel free to contribute to it and add more stuff to it over there. And as you can see, we have two files here, the index iOS and the index Android. The index Android is going to run when you're running in Android mode, when you run an Android app, and the index iOS JS is going to start when you're running, obviously, iOS. So in my app, I'm not doing pretty much anything here, but as you can see, I'm using the use strict, so every variable that needs to be declared, I'm calling React Native, and my app component, and you need to tell React which components you need. App registry is you only use it once to register your app. As you can see here, it's React.js Israel. And this is my main app component. I threw in a lot of code here, which is kind of boilerplate, but I'm just going to go over it quickly. This basically here wraps the entire project. It's the navigator. Every iOS app has that little navigator at the top that you slide into, and then every page you transition. It's basically this component here, navigator. But before we go into this, there are several components that you need to familiarize when you develop with React Native. The first one is the view. The view is pretty much like a div, like you use a div in any web app. And text, it's gotta hold all the text. You can't put text into a view without wrapping it into in a text tag first. Style sheet is where we're gonna have all our styles right here. And the rest of it should pretty much look familiar to everyone here who uses React before. We have a component called mount, setting some style to the status bar, and then I'm rendering this navigator. I'm not going to go too much into the navigator itself, like what each function does, but I'm mostly going to talk about the difference between navigator and navigator iOS, because I've seen this question come up a lot of times in Stack Overflow. There are two basically navigators that React Native gives you. One of them is the navigator iOS. This directly renders the official navigator that comes in the iOS. However, they found it to be not as great as they thought it would be. It's pretty strict. You can't modify it too much. And they ended up doing another version of the navigator, and they call it just navigator. What's great about it is, first of all, it's not tied into iOS. So they can take the same navigator and then throw it into Android, and without changing too much, it's going to work. So they're basically using reusable components here. You can, however, as you can see, it has one property that's called navigation bar, and if you pass to it the navigator navigation bar component, it's going to look and feel like an iOS component. So let's first of all look a little bit about our structure. As you can see, you can't really see it. I'm using Flux, so I have my actions here. We have the events action, which are going to use my API module. We're going to fetch the events from meetup.com. We have the event store, which is once it gets the event, it's going to emit the change to our events list, and then it's going to copy our list. So our main thing to see from this file here is that the component we're going to render into this navigator is our events list file. So let's look at the events list. In my events list, I'm using the style sheet, the view, the text, and list view. The list view, as you can see from the docs, basically it's a core component. It's designed to show you a list of items. Pretty much every app needs it and uses it. What you need to do is you need to initialize it with this code, which initializes the data source, and then it knows exactly which row has changed, and then it renders itself. So let's look at our events list here. My initial state here, I'm using their API here to initialize the list, and I'm saying that it's loaded false because I want to do something kind of like a loading, and then I'm going to get my events, and then once I get my events, then I'm going to render the list. When component did mount, I'm registering using Flux to my event store, and I'm telling the events action that I want to fetch some events. Once these events are fetched, my callback is going to change the data source. And again, this is pretty much the code that React tells you to use, that they will know how to differentiate which rows have changed and which ones are the same. And we're going to change the loaded from false to true so we can show the list. So here's my render function. And I'm asking basically if the state is loaded, if I already got the events, let's render something. And if I don't, let's render some loading text. So let's start. How do we even start this project? So once I did the init and I got all my files going, I need to start Xcode, okay? Here is my Xcode. A little hard to see, but basically the only thing that's interesting here in Xcode is this play button. Anything else here is irrelevant to us. What we can do is we can hit play. Sorry, I need to pick on the simulator. And you'll see that it's opening a terminal here, and it's basically running npm start. It's running npm start, and basically now it's doing this bundling thing. And there is a watchman package here, and it basically looks for any changes in my files, and then it recompiles these files together into this bundle, and we got it in our simulator. Now, I don't know if you noticed, but when I pressed play here, it took about 20 seconds to reload my app, which kind of sucks. Because imagine that every change you do, you have to wait around about 20 seconds for it to take effect. What's great about React is since our core code doesn't change, and mostly only our JavaScript, all we gotta do is hit Command R when we're in the terminal, and we reload it. And that was probably less than a second just to reload this. When you're in your simulator, if you hit Command D, you can either reload it, debug in Chrome, and all this great stuff here. We even have an inspector here, which is going to look pretty much kind of like the inspector in Chrome. You can see here the padding, the margin of whatever element I'm standing on. And we got to do some debugging, so let's debug in Chrome. This is our debugger in Chrome. So as you can see, I'm getting JavaScript here, I can put breakpoints here, I can light debugger, and we're going to stop here. So let's see, first of all, we got the JSON that we needed. So how about here, when the add events gets called, let's take a debugger here and see what happens. So I'm just gonna command R, and we're right there in the debugger panel. So you can see here your props and your state, and you see we're loaded false here. Let's see what's in our store. And you can see we have four JSON objects here, which is pretty much the events that we're looking for. Here is the one that we're here today, and so on. Great, so we know how to fetch the events, and as you can see also our loading text went away because we changed the state. So let's render this JSON, let's do something about it. So like I said, we're gonna get a list view. And the documentation is pretty great when it comes to React Native. Here is an example of list view. Okay, I'm just gonna grab it. So if the state is loaded, I have this view here with this style of container. It's gonna be flex one. Flex one basically means that it stretches as much as it can to fill the entire screen, and we got some padding top. So you can see it's very similar to CSS. We got font size and we can use margins and all that stuff. But we're doing basically we're developing for iPhone, which is pretty great. So the list view and the data source, it's the same data source we have in the state. And render row is basically what it's gonna render for each one of the items in our list. So let's create this method. So you can either use traditional JavaScript or you can use ES6. And our render row method, basically it's gonna give us the event. So let's see if we got it here. And here we are, let's see our event. So here's the first event with all the information, great. Now, let's just render something just to make sure that we have the right event. We're gonna render the names, okay? So we're gonna return. And we're gonna just throw in a text. And we're gonna show the event.name. And there you go, you have a list view right there with the name of the event. And that was pretty easy. Okay, so we're probably gonna want to do something more here, probably render a more complicated component here. So let's create a new component, which is gonna be the event row. Okay, I'm going to use some of the stuff in here. That'll be the event store, that'll be the event action, and I'll do this. So we have okay, we have our event row class here. And we're using the same syntax as in Node, module exports, and we're giving that the event row. Now, just for fun, what we're gonna do is I'm gonna break the code, okay? I didn't declare event row, and let's see what happens when I try to render this component, and we'll see how error is looking similar. So first of all, we need to call this this component. So event row, we're gonna require it. Event row. Great. So when we come to render the row, as we saw before, we're gonna render an event row, and we're gonna pass to it the event object. that we just got. So let's see what happens. So as you can see, I got this red screen of death here. And what's pretty great here is that I got this error here. You can see specification must implement the render method. So basically I'm trying to use a class here and it doesn't have the render. What's great here, I can just click this here and it shows exactly where this error happened. And this is where it initiated from, event row. It's basically telling me you created this React component and you didn't give me a render method, so it does nothing. So it's pretty easy to debug. So I'm gonna add the var to it, make it legal, and we're gonna use the render method. Let's wrap it in a view. And throw in the text that just came in, the event, the name of the event. So now it's in the props, but we pass it as a prop to this event, to this component, and I'm gonna call name on it. So let's see if everything is still working. Oh, it's not working. Let's see. Last component must be returned. Sorry? Good one. I'm used to CoffeeScript. Yeah, no need for these sealer returns. Awesome, working. Let's make it look a little bit more sexy. So we're gonna use the style sheet, okay? The style sheet, what's pretty great about it is that basically you write your styles, but what really happens underneath the hood is that they're changed into IDs. So when you call a certain style, you're actually calling an ID of a style. And this is for performance enhancement, so it works as quickly as possible. So we're gonna create this style of this row. Let's call it row container. And first of all, let's give it some height, so it doesn't look all cramped up. I don't know, maybe 70 points. So this is in points, right? We're doing iOS. And let's give it border bottom. How about just one pixel? And let's make the border color. What's a good color on it? For border. There we go. Okay, so we need to add this style to our view, to our div, right? So almost all React Native components, they use the prop called style. So I'm just gonna call from my styles. I'm gonna call row container, hit save. Let's see how it looks now.
Your declaration is in plural, in these bar styles.
Okay, you can see I have another error here. It's telling me border bottom is not a valid style, and I have all the properties that the style name accepts. So let's see what I messed up. Border bottom, and I need to tell it width. Great. Starting to look pretty decent, huh? Okay. What we want now is basically we have this list, and we have the summary of each event, and we want to go into the event itself and see more details about it. We want to see when is it happening, who are the speakers, description maybe, etc., etc. So let's handle a click event on this row, okay? So what we're gonna do is to the event row, we're gonna pass the onPress event. From the documentations, you can see that basically what you're doing, you hit press row, and then you pass it. So on press, we're gonna call navigate to do that. So let's first of all see if this is working. And it's not doing anything. Why isn't it doing anything? Because we haven't handled this. Our component is not supposed to handle. How much? Okay. Our component is not supposed to handle this kind of event. Okay? What we need to do is make a touchable component. Basically, what it means is we need to render a component which can accept interactions from the user. The most basic interaction component is called touchable opacity, which basically means that once the user taps on this row, it's going to run a function. So for our component, let's wrap it in touchable opacity. So I'm using the React component, telling to use touchable opacity. And on press, just for simplicity, I'm just going to call the onPress method which was passed to us. Close the tab, and let's see what happens now. So, we grab the event, and we're in our debugger, and now we want to navigate. So we need to use the navigator that we created in the beginning, and we have it in our props. And we want to give it the push method. Push method basically navigates forward in the navigator. So, we're going to call this props navigator. And we're going to push. And we need to give it two things. First of all, we need to give it the component that we want to render. So we're going to do whenever an event info component, title. I guess we should call it the event name. And we probably want to pass the event itself. Okay. But as you can see here, my method, I told it to receive this event property, but I didn't send it from our touchable opacity. So on press, I'm also going to pass it the props of the event which was used. So, let's create the event info component real quick, because we're running short out of time. I'm just going to duplicate this real quick. And let's get the name of the event. And this is now event info. So let's see what happens. We've got our list, and event info is defined. This is the component pushed into. Let's see. Missing. Anybody see it? Well, I'm missing it here. Sorry, guys. I'm sorry, I just didn't say it. Okay, so we actually, you can see that we tried to render the event info component, but it's telling us he doesn't know what name is, what the hell do we want from him. So let's stop here. We're gonna hit debugger right here in the event info. On the component the mount, will mount. And let's see what properties we have here. Okay, here we are in the debugger point, and let's see our props. So you can see we have the navigator and the route, and you will see that our event is actually inside the route. Okay, so under the props and route, we have event, and this is where our event is actually at. So we're missing here just the one route, and we should be pretty good to go. Let's see how it goes. Cool. So this is kind of messed up because the title is pretty long, but as you can see, we're shifting into our event, and we just need to give a little bit of padding there. As you remember, we have our actually component is actually hidden behind the navigator here. So we just need to give it some height, some margin top, or padding top actually. So flex one again, we want it to stretch as much as we can. Styles. Good catch. So here we got it right here. And of course, we can add all the different props and use them. So as you can see, basically, we sat here in about 20 minutes, something like that, we developed. Well, a very basic app, right? Of course, it needs more styling and development and design. But you got the bare bones here, and basically, this can easily be developed to any kind of generic iOS app, which people use all the time. Before I finish, I just wanted, spend like 2 minutes on this important thing called Interaction Manager. One of the great things about iOS apps and any mobile app is the fluidity. We want it to feel really smooth, and that's what we expect from great apps. As you can see here, this feels pretty smooth and feels quick, because our component that we're rendering here, it's basically, it's nothing. It's just text, right? But when we click here, what React does under the hood, it renders this entire page, and only then do we navigate into their next component. If our component here, it needed to do something really, really heavy, like fetch images, maybe load multiple tabs and stuff like that, there would be some delay from the time we clicked until we actually get the transition. So what we want to do here is we want to use the Interaction Manager. Interaction Manager tells us when a transition has completed, and then we can do the heavy stuff. So the app feels really, really smooth. So let's just look real quickly at how it works. Okay, this is we just need to call the Interaction Manager component. And when the component will mount, we're going to want to listen through this Interaction Manager and do something only once the transition is completed. So what we're going to do here, I'm going to give it an initial state. And I'm going to call it, let's say, loaded. Okay? And it's going to be on false. And right after the interaction is finished, that's when I want to change the state. Of loaded to true. And only then would I want to do something really, really heavy, because otherwise, like I said, everything would just hang. So let's for example, imagine that over here, instead of this view here, we're going to do something heavy, okay? So let's go okay, so here's my render something heavy method. And when it renders, we're gonna render this text and it's gonna say React with awesome. So first of all, let's just see if this still works. Okay, get initial state. This can be it. Definitely. And I'm going to return here. Okay, and we have the React is awesome here. So let's say that rendering this React is awesome text is really something heavy, takes a lot of resources, I don't know, grabbed it from the web. So we're gonna render it only once the animation finishes, so everything feels really super smooth, okay? So, if this state loaded, then we're gonna return this thing. Shift, we're going to navigate into our new page, and only once the animation finishes, we're going to see this React is awesome line. So let's see. Great, worked pretty good. So, I think we're pretty much right out of time, right? Yeah, I figured. So I hope you had a good time and this was informative. As you can see, as you saw, it was fairly easy to do what we just did. And I'm sure a lot of you can play with this at home and see how quickly you can develop great native apps. I know there are a lot of startups and companies that started using this, and I hope you had a good time, and thanks. And if anybody's interested, we're hiring, so just talk to me later, and thanks. Any questions, by the way?
I have a question.
Yes.
So you showed us that JavaScript errors are easily debuggable.
Mm-hmm.
Did you encounter any pitfalls where, like, the engine fails or something when you get a low-level exception where it's not JavaScript?
When it's the Objective-C code?
Yeah. Or any other pitfalls basically you showed us how easy it is,
mm-hmm.
and it looks like it. So I'm asking whether there are.
I did run a couple of times where when I got like low level exceptions at the level that the Xcode crashed or did crash, it basically stopped the simulator. But this happened only when I did something really horrendous with the JavaScript that basically React Native didn't know how to handle this, and then it got thrown up to the Objective-C code, and then this is where it crashed. Except of stuff like that, I don't think I ever had a really hardcore exception. Yes?
It's a question. Do you have an app with trends in production directly? Or if not, how far are you from that?
Do we have a minute? Like, just to quickly show the app that we're working on? Okay.
This is trend in production.
It's not in production yet. It's in internal testing right now. We hope to have it to external testing real quick.
And while loading this, second question is, did you have a use case when you had to write your custom, like when the existing components were not enough and you had to write your you know, JavaScript and your site on Objective-C and bridge them, so to make a real custom component, right?
Yes. He asked if I understood the question correctly. He asked if I've used external components, right, or had to write my own components to render on the screen. I did, and what's great about it is there's a really big community for React Native as well, and you can use other people's components, just like React reusable components. And I've written some components myself, published a couple of them, and it's very, very easy. And you still render Objective-C, but you call your JavaScript code. So this is our app. It's still in beta or alpha, not ready yet. But as you can see, it's a little bit more serious than what we just did. We got multiple tabs here, a little bit better navigation, side menu, avatars. You can call your comments and stuff like that, and you can interact with native components here, like the photos and so on. Any more questions?
Yeah.
You pointed out some common stuff that we have development and mobile development when we use React Native. Any differences that you didn't point out, like you try to communicate less with the server because of the mobile data or stuff like this?
So this is basically, it's not specific to React Native, your question. It's for any mobile development. You want to, first of all, you need to take into consideration that your users, they're using their 3G or 4G connection. They're not always on steady Wi-Fi. So you need to take that into consideration that sometimes your connection will drop. And you want to save data. You don't want to overload their data plan and stuff like that. So you want to try to use compressed images, and basically you want to use slim JSON as possible. And I think at least for me, when I'm using my phone, I don't want to wait a long time. I want stuff to be quick. So that's what using the interaction manager or using small JSON API calls, it's really what you need to focus on. Yes?
What about tests? How do you test the app?
So testing, first of all, if you want to do integration tests, there are several tools for iOS. Basically, you can use any tool that you want to use for integration tests, you can use here because it's Xcode, like you know. If you want to test your JavaScript code, you can use Jasmine, if you know it, or Jest. It's another thing made by Facebook for testing. I personally haven't used Jest so far, but I've used Jasmine for our backbone and Marionette apps, and it's fairly common and easy to use. Any other questions?
What is the size of the application?
The entire size of the application? You mean the project or the when it's packaged?
Yes.
I think it was like 1 megabyte for this, something like that.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a lot. Yes? You can use the local storage. There's an API which you can use. It's called async storage. Async storage right here. It's the storage, basically the storage of the app locally. What I use for login, when the user logs in, basically he gives the user a password, but for every query we send to the server, we need to pass the user and the password, because we want every query to be secure. So I save the user and the password on the device. I encrypt it, but it's saved on the device, and you can use it asynchronously to save whatever other data you need. I also know there's some guys using, basically doing kind of like SQLite on the device itself. So if you need some more heavy query SQL kind of stuff. Any other questions? Great, thanks a lot, guys.
תודה רבה על האפליקציה במיוחד, לחבר אותה לאתר של הקרינה כשהיא מוכן. בואו בוא ניקח הפסקה קצרה יחסית, כי קצת גלשנו. אני אשמח אם כולם יישארו להרצאה הבאה, שהולכת להיות מאוד מעניינת. נשארה קצת פיצה, אז למרות שאני הייתי רוצה מחליט בחושך.